So, country music, the quintessential, country and western music, the quintessential white music of the South, heavily influenced by blues music. Swing music, big band, heavily influenced by blues music. Meanwhile, out in the country, blues music was developing very differently. You know, way out in the plantations, things were very isolated. These were huge plantations. So you had people who had started off, playing this shuffle and singing, get pretty good at it, get to be a good singer, well then you can make a little money on a Saturday night. People are working 6 days a week out in the fields. Saturday night, it's time to let go. So you write a few songs, you write songs that make people feel good, get up and dance, you play at somebody in somebody's kitchen for a big party, people have got some cornbread, and they've got some beans and rice, and they got some whiskey and some beers or whatever they got, you know, to have a party on Saturday night. They need some music, and soon people start realizing, hey, you get good at the guitar. Everybody puts a little bit of money into the pot during the night. You're playing the guitar, make as much money as you make working out in the field for 2 days. If you can find another gig on a Friday night somewhere, you're making as much as you get in 4 nights. All you have to do then really is go find somewhere to play another couple of nights, and you're making the same money you are doing the physical labor. So people started doing exactly that. And these little guitars, the great thing about them, since they were plentiful and all over the place, is you could throw them in a gunny sack and hop the train, get into the next county and play music. People like, of course, the most famous of the Delta bluesmen would be who? Who would that be?
Robert Johnson.
So, what made Robert Johnson famous? His amazing talent at the guitar and his incredible songwriting ability. But what made him famous also was he was a very clever marketer. He heard stories, he liked them, he used them for himself. If, for instance, he heard Tommy Johnson saying that he had sold his soul to the devil to be able to play guitar better than anybody else, he no doubt heard that when he was in some town. He's trying to make a living playing music. But everybody's got to see this Tommy Johnson. Why? Because who are you going to go see? You know, here this Robert Johnson's quite good. Or are you going to go see Tommy Johnson who sold his soul to the devil to be able to play better than anybody else? I don't know about you, but my ticket money is going to see the guy who sold his soul to the devil. He's not going to be around for very long, right? So I want to go and catch that show. Especially if you're somewhere where Mississippi John Hurt maybe does the regular thing, or Fred McDowell, and it's the same person every Saturday. Now this guy comes into town saying that. Well, Robert Johnson hears that. He starts going around and telling everybody that he sold his soul to the devil. Met him at the Crossroads. The truth is, that's actually a British Isles story that dates back hundreds of years before the story of meeting the devil at the crossroads, selling your soul for something that you want, usually the love of a woman or somebody else's wealth or something like that, right? But in this case, the ability to pay. Well, why would that have such an appeal to the African Americans of the South who have been segregated their entire lives? Well, if they came from Mali or Senegal, if they came from a background that looked up to the griot class of people to sing and play music and keep the history of their people, well, then they would know that the griot class, who are not allowed to be married, buried in the same place as everybody else, because they had been affected by Legba, the trickster, who is a spiritual entity who gave you the ability to be able to play guitar and sing. Closest thing in Christian mythology would be the devil. So what would make more sense than meeting up with the devil to get these skills?